But when we walked in here this morning, they were chanting that the whole world is watching. This is what revolution looks like. Cultural
revolution. I don't have time for cultural revolution. It distracts from actual revolution.
The Trial of the Chicago 7, it's not a documentary. It's a painting where journalism is a photograph. It's not as much about 1968 as it is about today.
Our streets!
Who started the riots? Was it the protesters or was it the police?
If we leave here without saying anything about why we came in the first place, it'll be heartbreaking.
Our streets!
Our streets!
Our streets!
1968 was a bad year in America. March, Martin Luther King was shot and killed. 8 weeks later, Bobby Kennedy was shot and killed. This is all happening against the backdrop of the Vietnam War. Tens of thousands of 18-year-old kids were being drafted every month, going to Vietnam, getting massacred. So a group of activists, Abby Hoffman, Jerry Rubin, Tom Hayden, Dave Dellinger, Rennie Davis, John Froines, Lee Weiner, and an eighth, Bobby Seale, the head of the Black Panthers, came to Chicago to lead what were supposed to be peaceful protest.
This is it. It's time.
Rushing the police.
My name is Peniel Joseph, and I am a professor at the University of Texas at Austin, and I run the Center for the Study of Race and Democracy here at UT. In a lot of ways, 68 is going to be a showdown between two generations of Americans. You have this sort of multicultural, multiracial America that's coming into being.
There's a stereotypical idea of what a 60s demonstrator was. Some people meet that stereotype, but the Chicago 7 represented all kinds of different groups.
It's the Academy Awards of protest, and as far as I'm concerned, it's an honor just to be nominated.
My name is Imani Perry, and I am the Hughes Rogers Professor of African American Studies at Princeton University. 1968 is definitely playing a role in what we see today, how protesters are taking to the street, but also how states and the federal government are responding to them.
My name is Jamal Green, community organizer and entrepreneur in the city of Chicago. If you look at the protests today, they're not much different from what was going on in the 60s. The tactics change a little bit, but when you look at the leadership of each movement, what you see is people who are willing to risk everything for the people.
We watched for a decade while these rebels without a job tell us how to prosecute a war.
Section 2101 of Title 18.
That's the federal law that was broken.
That's the wraparound law.
Now, the law that the Chicago 7 were charged with breaking, conspiracy to cross state lines in order to incite a riot, or what was nicknamed the Rap Brown Law, that was passed in order to curtail the free speech of black activists in the South. That law, no one had ever been charged with it before. No one has ever been charged with it since.
We know you don't think we're criminals.
I think you got the result you were looking for.
So did Nixon.
Abby knew that it was a political trial, that it didn't matter what they said or what they did, they were going to jail. His aim was to use this opportunity to turn it into a huge media spectacle and draw attention to the Vietnam War.
You're asking for a parks permit.
There's gonna be a Festival of Life in Grand Park, and we're gonna insist that the next president of the United States stop sending our friends to be slaughtered.
You had this sort of progression of both the continued blooming of activism and also of the expansion of incarceration, the increased funding of police departments.
What's so extraordinary is that phrase that comes out of 1968, the whole world is watching, still resonates today.
The whole world is watching!
They were watching U.S. law enforcement brutalize men, women.
The whole world is watching!
We see a shift away from the beloved community into law and order.
Mr. Seale, would you identify the man sitting behind you?
His name's Fred Hampton.
Let the record indicate that Mr. Hampton is head of the Chicago chapter of the Black Panther Party.
Fred Hampton's legacy lives with all the activists around the country.
Bobby's life is at stake and you guys are playing to the crowd?
Thank you.
Shut up.
White guy sitting in a furnished room eating sandwiches while Bobby's sitting in a holding cell.
Fred Hampton really gained a deep respect across Black Chicago because he was able to broker peace between street gangs by virtue of political education.
Fred Hampton was shot and killed last night. There was a police raid and there was a shootout.
He was shot in the shoulder first.
You can't aim a gun if you've been shot in the shoulder.
I know for sure if what happened to Fred Hampton happened today, social media, there will be all kinds of information about what a bad guy he is. All you have to do is say he's a Black Panther. He's a terrorist. And no one would know who Fred was.
How many Fred Hamptons do we have for them to understand that Black people deserve justice and equality?
By the time you get to the 1980s, you see really the dropping off of one of the most vital periods of political organizing in U.S. history.
This doesn't mean that the radicals of Chicago 68 and the Chicago 8 are done and over. They're there, but they're going to be much more localized movements. You think about the election of Harold Washington in 1983 to become the first Black mayor in Chicago. We think about Jesse Jackson's run for president in 1984 and 1988, which really set the stage for Barack Obama in 2008. When we think about 68 and Grant Park, it's really extraordinary that 40 years later, Barack Obama is going to accept his election night victory in Grant Park. But certainly the progressive politics that are later going to lead to the almost passage of the Equal Rights Amendment, gay marriage being constitutional, they're still bubbling in the 70s and 80s. Like Tom Hayden said in 68, democracy is in the streets.
We're going to the convention! Get on the street! Get on the street!
I think the lasting impact of the Chicago 8 is this idea of transforming American democracy, and even the slogan, "The whole world is watching," showed us that violence wasn't coming and emanating from the ground up. Violence was actually emanating from the top down.
My most distinct memory is actually that image of Bobby Seale bound and gagged. I read that as a sign of one of the ways this country has responded to Black protest and protest generally.
I can't think of any meaningful change that's happened in this country or anywhere else that wasn't preceded by robust protest.
Hold them all accountable. Hold them all accountable.
With the murder of Breonna Taylor and George Floyd, there were times when watching CNN's coverage, I thought, you know, if you just degraded the color on that a little bit, it would look exactly like the file footage we used from 1968. So, we're not done learning the lesson yet.
Black Lives Matter!
These are folks who are answering the highest calling of citizenship and being persecuted and punished in America, the world's best known democracy, which is the irony and the tragedy of that.
When you look at those revolutionaries who are not afraid of police, who are not afraid of the government, those are people who usually have what it takes to fight for your people, as I am. New leaders will always be bred because the systems are not changing fast enough.
Whether we're given permits or not, we're coming.
Dissent is written into the Constitution for a reason. It's seen as a virtue, except when it feels as though it's challenging the powerful too much. And so articulating and re-articulating, this too is part of the tradition. This too is part of what it means to love a country. It's really important.
Now, how much is it worth to you? What's your price?
To call out the revolution?
My life.
The whole world is watching!
Thanks for watching. Subscribe to the Netflix Film Club channel to get our latest exclusive videos. Plus, hit the bell so you don't miss a single one.